Brambro here with some more Grand Tactician Civil War, our CSA campaign in version 1.06. Right. So we are in mid-August now. Last episode was mainly just some kind of campaign moves, jiggling a little bit with manpower and supply, and a little bit of blockade clearing on the coast. Not so much blockade clearing, that's been done before, but clearing out the forces that could start blockading again in the future. And that effort will continue. The Atlantic coast is now completely clear, even of forces that could blockade, and we still got a little bit more to do in the Gulf of Mexico, and the forces that are going to do that are repairing. So that will continue. I also had several little scouting gunboats along the Atlantic coast, and they're really not any longer needed for that role. So I've got some of these little scout rons moving over into the Gulf of Mexico, where they will eventually head up the Mississippi and join our scouters on the Ohio and the Mississippi rivers. I did tell one to stop kind of down here just to get eyes on what's going on with one of their blockade fleets that I think came down here to Key West. So we'll get eyes on that as well. So that's the naval piece of what is going on here as we get toward the end of summer 1862. In the Virginia theater, not much change. I think we can turn the front lines off. Talking the last episode about Virginia state support, Virginia troops, and we've got a few brigades coming up to just kind of help mitigate that situation to Lee's Army of Northern Virginia. Other than that, hasn't been much change and probably won't be any immediate change in the near future. Got a little bit going on here along the Ohio River. In the Army of Tennessee, under the command of Joe Johnston, Albert Sidney Johnston's Texas Corps has captured Evansville, Indiana, which helps kind of solidify our hold on the lower Ohio up as far as Louisville. And now Johnston is raiding along the Indiana side of the Ohio on his way up to Corydon, Indiana, not too far from Louisville. He is not in good supply shape at all. They don't have any food, they don't have any forage, and their supply flow is 26%. But they're raiding, and what they're not short of, well, actually they are a little short of ammo. Huh. So I don't know how this is going to turn out. Like, how are they losing ammunition? They're running along here raiding. They're not fighting anybody. Are they shooting pigs? What my intention is that Johnston is going to raid along here up to Corydon, and then we are going to attack the Army of the West, which is sitting here just across the river from Indiana, and they're sitting on top of a fatly provisioned supply depot, and that's where Johnston is going to resupply. So these Yankees are going to have to fight some hungry Texas boys soon. Hopefully with Evan Kirby Smith's support. Certainly should be able to. One would hope. Let's move him up a little closer just to make sure. It'll be a while before Johnston gets over there. I think that's close enough without actually starting a battle. And I've moved Johnston's HQ back over this way a little bit, so that the 3rd Engineers remain within his command radius. Who sent him over here in order to get some eyes on the Army of the Ohio, sitting at Frankfort, which he has done. And this army is up to 30,000. Fun times. The Army of Tennessee together, now that we've got two corps in it, is 56,000. So, okie dokie. Right. That's what's going on in the Central Theater along the Ohio. Over in Missouri, Beauregard and Sterling Price are kind of doing what they've been doing. Fighting Yankees. Defending against Yankee attacks. Back down in Springfield, got a little bit of a artillery ammunition problem with Price's Corps. And this seems a little strange to me. We've got multiple instances going on of forces dropping in ammo without having recently fought. Even in 1.06 beta in the last campaign, I don't remember seeing that before. Food, I understand. Forage, I understand. They're continually consuming that stuff as they march. Got it. Ammunition? I don't quite understand that. Anyway, that's what's happening. Price was at about 40-ish percent, 41% ammo, artillery ammunition, before he ran up here and grabbed some out of a depot up here, burned it down, and then came back down. And he, so in the course of that, he's actually dropped, specifically in artillery ammunition. All right, enough whining about that. So that's what's going on in the various theaters, and let's roll time. Oh wait, there is one other interesting thing I want to point out. Talked in a previous episode about army upkeep and how mine was pretty high. Take a look at this. Army upkeep, 231 million. That is less than half of what it was just a couple of months ago. So I'm super happy that it has dropped that low. And you can see here in the trend, you know, we were above 500 million in army upkeep, much higher than the Federals. And then we had a big drop off right here down to around 400 million. And I think this had something to do with logistic reforms, and even though it should be manifesting itself differently, may have had something to do with me taking the Revenue Act. Logistics reform should have caused a drop, but it was only a 5% drop in supplies, so it doesn't seem to me like it should have been that big. And then I took the Revenue Act around the same time, so that's the only other thing that I can think of that made it drop off so much, although that should manifest itself with improved revenue and therefore increase the revenues up here, but shouldn't really affect expenses, right? That's what would make sense to me. And then we carried on about in the 400 million range, and then boom, we just had a huge drop off right here. Like literally just within the last couple of weeks. And I don't know what I did to make this happen. So I'm very happy that it's low. I'm not happy about not understanding how and why this happened so that I can replicate that behavior in the future. The only thing I can think of is, can shifting the Texas Corps into raid mode have caused that big a drop? I mean, it's only one out of six corps. I'll be interested to see what happens to army upkeep later when we take the Texas Corps back out of raid mode. Okay. Somebody arrived where they were supposed to go. Rousseau. Oh, yeah. I just kind of fiddled with the position of this river squadron over here. We have a very strong defense against any federal force that may come down the river toward Cairo. We have a fort here, and right behind it, we have a river squadron that has a couple of cottonclads and a tinclad? Timberclad. I'm not sure exactly. We have two cottonclads and one timberclad in this squadron, which I think this squadron should be able to handle. Any federal squadron that comes down the river. And this is just a scouter right here. Okay, Johnson is raiding along here. Again, not doing good on supply. So far, his men are remaining in good condition. Oh, they're dropping. They're now down to sufficient. Morale's still okay. His attrition is not great. It's not terrible. Yeah. Smoke starting to come up from raided IIPs as he gets close. Historical flavor there. People are pissed at Lincoln. What effect is that rating having? Wow. Infrastructure recently occupied, transport capacity wasn't actually occupied, but we're rating it. I think it's what's causing. Oh, Army of the Tennessee is coming down. Okay, there's kind of a fight brewing here. How many men are in the Army of Tennessee? 7,000. I think there's 15,000 in the Army of the West. Oh, he's getting on the river. Skirmishing going on. Interesting. So the army and corps level perks that pertain to skirmishing, I think pertains to campaign map skirmishing. All right, Scout Rontan, you need to come down here and chase away this army that's trying to use my river. Oh, yeah. Retreat. Go back. Yeah. Okay, Johnson's getting a little bit more supply. Where's Army of the Tennessee trying to go here? Alright, let's shift the Texas Corps back into regular mode. Just stop for a second, see what's going on in other theaters. Johnson picked up quite a bit of XP. All he's done is capture Evansville and then raid just right there. You saw what he did. He's already picked up most of a perk slot. That's good to know. And he's getting a little bit of provisions and forage now. Yeah, he's in good shape again. For supply, his condition needs to come back up. Okay, static in Missouri, cool. And how about in Virginia? Anything happening up here? Nope. Nope. So, question is the Army of the West going to fight when we come up here and grab this supply? Or chase him away? Actually, he's already in good shape again. Question is, are these guys going to reinforce? I think they're too far away. I think they are. All right, Texas Corps. You've captured a city. You've raided. Now it's time for your combat debut against the Army of the West. Which, oh, by the way, they did fight before. This force was originally in Missouri, and I think this was the first federal army that Price defeated way back at the beginning of the campaign. Some Native Americans are a little testy with the Federals over in Minnesota. Probably understandably enough, I would imagine. Looks like somebody's retreating. Oh, we just caught sight of an army up there that I don't think we've seen before. Okay, how come I'm not capturing the supply depot? There they are. Army of the Illinois is 11,000. 6,000 right now, 11,000 recruited. So, okay, there it goes. It just took a second for that to flip, but he was already drawing supply from this depot. So, that worked out. Oh, look, they're building another depot for us up here. How kind of them. So I'm a little, I built this telegraph line all the way down through here, which should shorten the distance. However, no, the game is still drawing the line all the way down through here and back up to the Army of Tennessee. Just kind of like, take the shortest path from the capital, which is Richmond. So I'm going to see if that situation can be helped, but, well, no, because there's an army down here. Of 7,000 men, and nothing between it and our darn iron mine. Oh, wait a minute, no, we can't have this. We cannot have this. Now wait just a minute. Okay, so that's a Union iron mine now. Got it. However, did I not upgrade this iron mine to tier 2 like quite a few episodes ago? Pretty sure I did. That's what got us up to 84,000 production. All right, well, I mean, guess what? Knoxville and this mine are more important than anything in Kentucky. So, it is only 7,000 men. I don't need to send the entire damn Army of Tennessee down there. So I am going to send Sidney Johnson and the Texas Corps down to this area via rail. Or river, if he finds a quicker way to do that. He'll come up here and chase the Army of the Tennessee away and get our Iron Mine back. They may capture Knoxville before he gets around there. It's possible. Okay, then. And he is going to be out of range of Joe Johnston for all that. I don't think they're going to take a morale nerf from that, though. I think they're just going to lose their in-range morale buff. It's back up to good condition. Since he got his boys some victuals, the supply depot across the river. Now, did we lose control of that depot by doing that? Not yet. Let's move Kirby Smith's Corps right up close. Well, we just issued some more bonds. Yeah, so, you know what? That Texas Corps is not in raid mode anymore. And we came back up a little bit. But not so, you know, it's still below 300 million. So, I don't think raid mode explained this enormous drop we had right here a couple of weeks ago in game time. If this graph, it's hard to read these graphs because these dates all run together down here. And my increasingly elderly eyes. It looks like this occurred like in mid-July, I think. So, I don't know, it's hard to tell. It was pretty recent, though. I wonder if clearing the last blockaded port did that. If anyone's got any ideas on what could have caused that massive drop, I'd sure love to hear it. Because it's something that I would want to do, like, on purpose, instead of get lucky in the future. Army of the Tennessee is continuing on south. He has gone. No, he did not capture Knoxville. So that means either he just walked on by, not caring, didn't take the time to capture it, or it might be in raid mode. That's just a position report. We don't actually see, which means if he's in raid mode, we wouldn't see the icon on his NATO symbol there. Well, he's about to get chased back up into Kentucky. Whoa! Well, he's not fooling around there. It looks like he's moving on the river. Huh. Okay, let's get... apparently we need to get some gunboats down here to stop the Federals from using the Tennessee River. Let's bring Scout Run 9 down here. And Thought I'd turn blockade off on these guys. We'll bring Scout Rotten 16 down here. So just because he's sitting right at the mouth of the river anyway. Well, I think Johnson's about to catch sight. Speaking of which, got a few of our Scout Rons from the East Coast over here now. I don't really want them blundering into this fleet. Let's just bring them up here first. Speaking of this fleet, how is CSS Virginia doing on her condition? 97%. Almost there. Want her at a full 100 before she goes over there, because she's going there by herself. Okay. This guy's still in the river? Doesn't seem like it. No, they don't have the on-river symbol. But they got the Texas Corps headed their way. What you gonna do now, whoever's commanding Army of the Tennessee? Yep. Boom. Okay, I did not expect that. Army of the Tennessee is routed, every man for himself. Many parts are trying to reform the next closest town, well, which is a long damn way away. Wow. Okay. Well, that problem resolved a little bit quicker and easier than I thought it was going to. More of that. Alright, well, Texas Corps, come on back up. Clearly, though, need to do something about this route. He just came right on down here. Hmm. I guess we better go over and engage these armies and assert control over this route through eastern Kentucky. Not because I care about this part of eastern Kentucky, but because I care very much about East Tennessee. Damn it. Sneaky Yankees. I forgot. Did I tell? I didn't. Alright, come on back up, Texans. Okay. These Yankees are being quiet. That's fine. And these Yankees are being quiet. Ah, another supply depot building up here that we may be able to go grab sometime in the future. Price, how are you doing on your... And why are you taking... How are you burning artillery ammunition? Down to 24%. Hasn't fired a shot. I wonder how this horse artillery is doing. They're dropping too. And what exactly is Price taking attrition from? He's still got a few wounded, okay. From previous battles, an 800 sick in the summertime, although he's had a little bit of rain. I don't understand what's going on with artillery ammo. Well, there's another darn army headed down there. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to come over here and we're going to defeat the Army of the Ohio. We're going to establish control over these darn IIPs. And I may have to send a corps back down to chase the Army of the Illinois. Which is about 11,000 men. Let's seal this off first, and then I'll send somebody down to get them. Okay, we've lost sight of the Illinois Army. Well, the unit is gone for the draft. Oh, by the way, we're into early September, which means, econ and intel time. Okay, credit running remains the same. We did issue some more debt, $565 million national debt now. Which was not enough to drop our credit rating, so that's good. Recovery, economy and recovery. Wealth is mediocre and now decreasing. Okay. And our tax revenues are down a little bit. Not good. No buildings. Imports and exports continue to increase. We're not really closing the relative gap ratio-wise. Corporate production dropped a little bit. Yeah, iron is off so coffee, that's just the way it's going to be. Coffee cannot be produced domestically, it's an import. Still food and locomotives. Fish, salt, and wood, same as last time. How about intel? Yep, we just saw them do the Enrollment Act. And they've also done the recruiting project. So they're getting a big manpower boost here. 8,500 men recruited in three brigades. That's going to be three full-size infantry brigades there, pretty much. Or actually, probably two full infantry brigades and a full cav brigade. And they went into the Army of Illinois, which is causing us a little bit of consternation. And another fleet. Oh, at Baltimore. So they formed this in order to go after that Chesapeake blockade squadron I set up. ...92% morale in their armies. And they're still carrying out offensive operations. Yeah, we see that. And they're running armies down into East Tennessee. All right, Johnson, come on up. Let's bring the engineers up. All these troops have done stuff. Moving, raiding, capturing cities. None of these troops have actually fought in tactical combat yet. Neither has the Army of the Ohio. Okay. going to put him on tactical mode or defensive mode. I think in the last episode I was about to discuss why I do that. A, I think it increases the chance of getting a defensive situation, which is advantageous, as Price and Beauregard have shown countless times in this campaign. B, being in defensive mode, I think will increase their engineering points for that defensive battle, which should also be increased by the fact that, where is he? Joe Johnston is an engineer. That should help. And then finally, being in defensive mode, even if acting offensively on the campaign map, it's kind of like strategic offensive, tactical defensive. When you make that first contact, even if you're the one making it, or even if the player, I, am the one making it, then it increases the chance of being able to initiate it with a siege. And as we saw earlier in this campaign, that, I think, creates opportunities to isolate a core from being reinforced when in other circumstances it might be reinforced. We kind of saw that happen in Virginia. And Johnson has a perk. I'm going to do the same thing I did with Lee. I'm going to go with embedded reporters. Let's take these engineers out of scouting mode. Let's go ahead and have, which is the, Kirby Smith has the larger of the two corps, and that's because he has 9 infantry brigades, whereas Sidney Johnston has 7. So let's go ahead and bring the Texas Corps up to about here. We'll use Kirby Smith's corps to come over here and make contact with the Army of the Ohio. Okay. Well, I thought that would be close enough. Does he have to actually cross the river? I guess he does. Fine. That ought to do it, huh? Yeah. We've got them. There weren't really any closer cores anyway. He wasn't going to get reinforced. Well, somehow, Kirby Smith has got a problem brigade. 156 men. So one of his artillery battalions is apparently not happy. I wonder if I missed a Kentucky battalion. Maybe I was looking too much at the infantry units and I missed the artillery battalion that's Kentucky Troops. Well, I don't think one artillery battalion is going to make a big difference here. And so Smith's Corps engaging and Texas Corps 0 hours will either be on the field at the beginning or will be there extremely quickly. The Army commander says 8 hours, but I bet he's going to be there at the start of the fight. We'll see if he is. But I believe that this will occur during the next episode. So it'll be a little different, at least a different cast of characters, and we'll have a different map. I think in this part of Kentucky, it's probably going to be the Perryville map, which is kind of broken and a lot of forest, and so it's another one of those maps. We got 164 guns to his 52, so we've got a huge artillery advantage if we can find good fields of fire for them. And of course, we've got significantly more troops overall. So, that'll be the next episode. If you like what we're doing with the channel, if you like the content, then leave a like, leave a comment, perhaps even subscribe if you would like. At any rate, thank you very, very much for watching. I appreciate it.